on this, on this beautiful Mother's Day. We welcome you. I'm Kim Hamby, and as Joey likes to say, I am just tickled pink to be a member here of the First United Methodist Church. If you want to take a look at your bulletin lots going on around the church, and we invite you to become active parts of the body of Christ within our church. Lots going on, including today. Normally, we're used to getting a little bookmark or a little something for Mother's Day. However, today we have gotten a better use of our funds. Instead of giving you a nice bookmark or some seeds to plant, we're planting better seeds. And we're giving a donation for the equal amount of what we would spend on those trinkets. We're sending that money to our infant rescue center in Kenya. So that's a good, wonderful use of our funds. Also, June 3rd through the 5th, they need volunteers. And so if you mark that on your calendar as well, if you can donate some time for the annual conference coming up in Paducah, June 3rd through the 5th, I'm sure everyone would be appreciative. They need medical team members, ushers, greeters, parking lots, attendants, transportation, and shuttle drivers. So if you've got your CDL, that would be awesome. But lots going on that you can circle and attend. If not, you're asked to pray for those events that you will not be attending. Otherwise, we would like to invite you for our opening prayer now. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden.
Sweet nature of Mother's Day for some. We are cognizant of the fact that there are folks who see this as a difficult day because of loss, because of the pain and suffering that goes along with the difficulties of relationships sometimes, and sometimes the absence of children. And so we recognize that not everyone sees Mother's Day the same, but God is with us. Best of all, God is with us. And no matter how you face Mother's Day, you do not face it alone, especially today. Would you join me in the prayer of illumination, and then we'll follow that up with a litany for Mother's Day. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. The Litany for Mother's Day is a way for us to recognize the specialness of this day and to keep ourselves aware of the different ways that this day will be observed. The words will be on the screen for all of us. Everyone here is either a son or a daughter. We got to go back one, y'all. We'll go ahead. Mothers come in many different forms, and today we celebrate them all.
Thank God for mothers.
Everyone here is either a son or a daughter.
Thank God for my mother.
For those women who have joined God in heaven and whom we miss dearly here on earth.
Thank God for the mothers of the past.
For every woman who is working day and night to raise her children, even now.
Thank God for the mothers of today.
For all the women who are expecting but aren't quite mothers yet.
Thank God for the soon-to-be mothers.
For the women who took in others' children through adoption and foster care.
Thank God for the mothers who are so needy.
For those women who have lost a child to death and must carry on.
Thank God for the mothers who are so strong.
For all the women who have desperately wanted to have children of their own, but chose instead to mother everyone else.
Thank God for the mothers who
We thank you, Lord, for the women who have influenced our lives in so many ways. We pray that we will honor them in everything we do. Amen. Now we invite the children to come forward for a message that's just for them. You're invited to listen in as we sing a verse.
This morning, are you going to? Yeah? Maybe you got her card that says, Mom, I love you. Do you think your mom's like to hear you say that you love her? They love to hear you say that you love them? Well, when I say so on the count of three, we're going to say Happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there. Does that sound good? Okay. One, two, three. Good job. But you know what your... Do you know what your mom likes even more than to hear you say that you love her? Yeah, to clean the house and your room. Well, they might, though, because what do you think you're doing when you do that for her? You're not saying that you love her, but you're showing her that you love her so much. What are some ways that you can show that you love your mom besides cleaning the house in her room, in her bed, and all the things that she said?
You
clean your dog's dish. Oh, you can clean your dog's, yeah. So do you think God likes to hear us say that we love him? Yeah? I know he does, but do you think he likes us to show him that we love him more than that? Yeah? How can you show that you love God? Do you pray, go to church? What else? You can write him a letter saying that you love him? That sounds good. So, the Bible tells us that God showed his love for us by sending his one and only son so that we might live through him. And it goes on to say, since God loved us so much, we ought to love one another. One of the best ways to show God that you love him is to love one another. Yes, God likes to hear say, I love you, but he'd rather hear you say to others, I love you. As we celebrate Mother's Day, let's tell Mom that we love her, but more important, let's remember to show her that we love her. And as we worship today, let's tell God that we love him, but more importantly, let's remember to show him we love him by loving others. Will y'all pray with me? Hey God, we have come to your house today to say I love you. Help us to go out into the world and show you that we love you through our actions. Amen.
For the affirmation of faith, I'm going to ask you to stand in body or in spirit as you are able. As we recite together the Apostles' Creed, that which we believe, that which we hold fast to. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Intercede on behalf of those folks around you, to remember the difficult places in your life, to remember the opportunities you have to give thanks. Following the moment of silent prayer, I'll pray a pastoral prayer, and I'll ask you to join me in the Lord's Prayer. But for now, pray for yourself. Pray for the people around you. Pray for the mission and ministry of Mayfield First United Methodist Church, and that God might be a transforming agent within the world through us. Let us pray. Good morning, God. We are so grateful for the chance to once again come into your presence to worship you in spirit and in truth. And as we recall the joys of Mother's Day and face the difficulties of Mother's Day, we ask that your presence would be felt all the more strongly. We give thanks for the many blessings of this life, and we seek to be about the business of your Son, Jesus Christ. For as we close out the season of Easter and look forward to the season of Pentecost, we recognize that there comes a moment when we are on our own, not completely, not fully, but there came a moment in the lives of the disciples when Jesus said his goodbye. But he promised them a comforter, the coming of the Holy Spirit. And so today we stand in the in-between, between the actual presence of Christ in our lives in the presence of your Holy Spirit. Teach us what it means to operate as individuals, to take the initiative, O God, to speak truth to the people around us in love, and to share with them the grace that we have received ourselves, that they might know the salvation that you have given to each of us. We ask all of this, Lord, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, for he taught those self-same disciples how to pray with these words, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. This time we invite the ushers to come forward. As they do, this is a chance for me to remind you that if you have a tithe pledge here at Mayfield First, this is your chance to exercise that promise. If you are a part of another congregation and your pledge is elsewhere, hold on to what you have. Take it home with you. They'll be expecting it, I can assure you. If you don't have a tithe covenant, now it's just a good time for you to make a gift that will honor God. And it doesn't necessarily have to be what goes into the plate, although those gifts, I promise you, will be used for the ongoing cause of Christ and his kingdom. If you have another gift that God is asking you to use, a resource of your time, your talents, whatever that may be, know that this is a good time for you to dedicate that to Almighty God. Let us pray. And now, Lord, we ask your blessing upon the gift and upon the giver, that the kingdom of Jesus Christ might come. All this we pray in his precious name. Amen. We have some scripture to read together from the book of Acts, the first chapter. This is the departure, the ascension. Today is, after all, Ascension Sunday. And while we're focusing on mothers, we're focusing on the presence that leads and guides us as well, Jesus Christ. For those disciples who knew Jesus, saw him face to face, I want you to imagine what it would be like to go through all that they had been through, all the years of the ministry of Jesus, all the difficult times that they had had, the arguments they'd had with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, all the difficulties of the arrest and the trial, his torture, his resurrection. Hear these words as we read them to one another in that context and prepare yourself. During this time, Peter stood up in the company. There were about 120 of them in the room at the time, and said, "Friends, long ago the Holy Spirit spoke through David regarding Judas, who became the guide to those who arrested Jesus. That scripture had to be fulfilled, and now has been. Judas was one of us and had his assigned place in this ministry. Judas must now be replaced. The replacement must come from the company of men who stayed together with us from the time Jesus was baptized by John up to the day of his ascension, designated along with us as a witness to his resurrection." They nominated two: Joseph Barsabbas, nicknamed Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "You, O God, know every one of us inside and out. Make plain which of these two men you choose to take the place in this ministry and leadership that Judas threw away in order to go his own way." Then they drew straws. Matthias won and was counted in with the 11 apostles. This is the word of God for you who are the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. And now, God, we ask your blessing upon the hearing and the reading and the understanding of this, your word, that we might be transformed, that we might be led, that we might know your will. We ask this for the sake of the name of the Christ. Amen. I have a couple of stories that you've probably heard if you've been in conversation with me around the will of God. One's the fellow who's in the flood. If you've heard this, then meditate quietly as I tell it to the folks who haven't heard it. There's a guy who's in a flood, and the folks come by and say, "The water's rising. It's going to be up over your front porch in just a few minutes. You've got to get out of here." And he says, "No, God's going to save me." Okay, off they went. Sure enough, porch gets covered. The water's coming in the house. Guys come by on a raft, and they say, "You got to get out now while the getting's good. Get on this raft." "Nope, the Lord is going to save me." They paddled away. He crawls up to the roof of his house eventually, and the water is still rising. And a helicopter comes down over the house. It's gotten a little darker, and the spotlight's on him, and the speaker bursts to life and says to the fella, "You've got to come with us. You're going to die in this flood." And he shouts back, "The Lord is going to save me." Moments later, he was swept away in the flood and died. And as he approached the throne of God, he was a little miffed. He said, "Lord, I told all those people that you were going to save me. And what happened? I died in that flood." And the Lord said, "Look, I sent 3 search and rescue parties to save you." I think that we sometimes confuse ourselves about what the will of God is for us. And we get real excited about what it's supposed to look like. We get real excited about how things are supposed to go. And we miss it when it comes to us. We are waiting for a pronouncement from a burning bush. We are waiting for some kind of message to be written across the expanse of the sky in the very stars. A lot of folks look to the stars for their guidance. And let me just say this. Astrology has been debunked over and over and over. If you're looking for something that's going to tell you about who you are and what your life is about, don't consult the stars. Consult the one who made the stars. When you get down to it, though, God's will is not always something that's easily discerned. We have these particulars. We have this certain specific way that we think things ought to be done. And when they don't come about in the way that we're expecting, it's confusing to us. Well, the disciples, at least, knew their limitations. They were aware that even though the Holy Spirit was a part of who they were going to be, they knew that they were not yet ready to make this decision. Who's going to be the next apostle? So they drew straws. That always blows me away. Now, what they actually did was they cast lots. And we're not sure what that looks like, whether it was stones with little markings on them. You've been seeing dice on the screen. I know some of you thought this was going to be a sermon about gambling. That's later. This is about casting lots. This is about letting God control what happens when we release the dice, when we release the coin to flip it in the air. They were assured that whatever they saw as results from casting lots would reflect God's will. I'll be honest with you. I don't know what to do with that. I don't know what to think about that. I'm not sure that God wants us to tap into this almighty mystery in ways that involve dice or coins or the drawing of straws. But on the other hand, I can get where the disciples are coming from. It's hard to know the will of God in these particular things. Here's what I want you to understand about all this, though. There's way too much about being a Christian disciple that is not left to chance. It's not accidental. It's not a coincidence. It's a convergence of the message that Jesus came to share with us and willing hearts who are able and ready to receive that message and then do something with it. People ask me, what was your call like? And I disappoint a few people when I say, well, there were no lasers, there was no descending dove, there's no burning bush. I just sort of had this moment where I realized this is what I ought to be doing. I was at Lakeshore, and it made sense when I looked around that this was no accident. There is a creator. And the one who created all this is someone who loves us. I knew that from my growing up. I knew that from Sunday school. I knew that from Bible school. I knew that from the love that had been shared with me by friends and family, folks in the church. And I don't think that it required me to flip a coin. I don't remember drawing straws at that moment. As a matter of fact, we have a very rigorous process in the United Methodist Church for determining fitness for ministry. We don't question anyone's call. We just help them to shape and understand that call. My call was no different in terms of being in need of shaping and finding a new understanding of who it was that God was calling me to be. So you see, just like we know that both of these men, Joseph Barsabbas and Matthias, Joseph was called Justice. Justice and Matthias were both capable of being apostles. Did you get that part? They just decided that there was only one slot left. They could only take the place of one man. And since there were two of them, they had to eliminate one. Do you think that Justice didn't have a ministry of his own after that? He went out and did great things in the name of Jesus. He didn't throw his hat on the ground and say, well, if I don't get to be in, I'm not going to do this at all. If he didn't make the cut that one time, it didn't mean that he wasn't supposed to do something great in the name of Jesus. It's that time of year where a lot of my colleagues are packing up and moving.
And I can remember a time when I first got into ministry when pastors would stand around at retreats, and they'd sometimes stand around even as late as annual conference, and they'd kind of scuff the ground and say, I really wanted to go to thus and such United Methodist Church. I thought I was going to get to go here. I was going to get to be this. One of these days, I'm going to get to go here. And they would talk about where they thought they were supposed to serve. And I realized after I'd been in ministry for about 3 or 4 years, that kind of thinking isn't a good thing. So now when people ask me, do you know where so-and-so's going? I might if I happen to see it on Facebook, or if they shared it with me in a private conversation. But gone are the days when I would call people up and say, what have you heard? Gone are the days when I would take people to lunch and try to figure out, where are you going? What are you doing? Who's going to so-and-so? Is so-and-so still retiring this year? Is this church going to open up? And then we would map those runs and try to figure out who was going where. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. We go to the places where we are called to go. And when the bishop calls on us to go to these places, we go with glad hearts or we go with sad hearts, but we go. We go and we serve. And it is the example of Jesus that we're following. It is the example of the disciples that we are following. And however the cut is made, and believe me, there have been conversations about whether or not the cabinet was even awake when they made some of the decisions they've made over the years. And some of the members of the cabinet will tell you this as well. What were we thinking? But I'll tell you this. God works with our brokenness. God is able to do great things with us. Whether it's the flipping of a coin or the casting of lots or the rolling of the dice or the slapping that spit in your hand to see which way to go when you come to the fork in the road. No matter what your decision-making process, I encourage you to be open to the movement and leadership of the Holy Spirit, because you can leave a lot of things to chance. But know this and bank on it. The presence of God in your life depends upon only one thing, and it's not the roll of the dice. It depends on whether or not you are willing to embrace the fact that it is there. So what does that look like? How does that work? Sometimes it means that you act with confidence when you aren't really sure that you have that kind of confidence. Sometimes it means going forward with courage, even when you're terrified. Sometimes it means doing something different when everybody says, don't change the way we've been doing this. Sometimes it means going so far against the grain that people look at you and say, have you lost your ever-loving mind? But they said the same thing to Jesus. They said the same thing to the other disciples, not just Judas. They said this to Justice. They said this to Matthias. I've heard it myself, and I'm sure you have too. You crazy church people, what are you thinking? Doing this, that, or the other thing, sending money off to who knows where. What do they do with the money? Do you even know? Sometimes we do and sometimes we don't. But you see, my friends, that's what faith is about. It's about recognizing that when we give ourselves over to God, we're not leaving things to chance. We may make some crazy decisions sometimes, but we're not leaving things to chance. I want to say a quick word about what that might imply for some people. Some folks think that just because God has things in control, that everything's written out, that it's all lined out, and everything that we do goes into play because it's the way God lined it out. That sort of predestinarian way of thinking takes all of the responsibility off of us. And if that were true, there would be no passages like the one in the Old Testament where Joshua says, as for me and my house today, we choose to follow the Lord. It would take out a whole lot of places where key decisions were made to stand up and follow Jesus, or to not follow Jesus, as in the case of the rich young ruler who turned around and left when Jesus told him about the difficulty of being a disciple, of being a Christ follower. I want to make sure you understand that only in those cases where we're not sure what to do next would it ever behoove you to flip a coin. The rest of the time, it's up to us to pay attention, and to make those decisions that we know will honor God, the decisions that we know will bring glory to Christ's name, the decisions that we know will bring us closer in fellowship with one another and deeper in ministry to the world around us. It's time for us to stop leaving it to chance. It's time for us to stop saying, well, if God wills it, it'll be so. I was told once upon a time by a member of my congregation after I had preached a series on stewardship and giving. He said, I always thought it'd be a good idea just to take my money and throw it down the steps. And whatever landed on the top step would be God's, and everything that landed closer to the bottom would be mine. I said, well, how hard are you throwing it? And he said, yeah, pretty hard. There's a variation on that theme that I was told once upon a time. A fella said, I'm going to draw a circle, and I'm going to throw my money up in the air. Something about throwing money in the air. I don't get this. I'm going to throw my money up in the air, and everything that lands inside will be God's, and everything that lands outside, I'm going to keep. The fellow next to him said, I'm going to do the same thing, but I'm going to let God have whatever falls outside the circle instead. Third fellow says, you guys got it all wrong. I'm going to draw a circle on the ground. I'm going to throw my money up in the air, and whatever God wants, he can grab on the way up. That kind of intentionality is not what I'm talking about. That's the kind of thinking that says it's me against God. And God's in this to get what God gets. And I've got to hold on to what's mine so that God doesn't take it away. That's not what any of this is about. This kind of thinking that we see in this passage is driven by the fact that these two men both wanted to be as close to the heart of the ministry of Jesus as they could possibly be. They knew that having followed Christ around since his baptism in the River Jordan under John's supervision, they knew that they had been on the outskirts of something huge, and they just wanted to get to where they could do some more good in this movement. But there's only room for one. I think that's the saddest part of this entire story. There was only room for one. That's not true at all. Not here, not today. So we can take this passage of Scripture and we can hear this story and we can say, you know what? This table stretches. There's room at this table for everybody. There's room for everyone who wants to be near to the heart of God. There is room for everyone who wants to give their part, to do their portion, to exercise their gift. There's room for everyone, no matter what the gift. And sometimes we have to admit there's room even for the folks who don't have a gift. But I'm not sure that those people really exist. Instead, I think that all of us have been gifted for ministry. And instead of standing back and saying, no, let's just flip a coin and see if Matthias or Justice is going to get this. Let's say instead that there's no need to flip a coin. There is instead only the simple need for that commitment to be made in the depths of your heart, in the root of your mind, to say and to do those things that Jesus has called upon us to do. To love our neighbor as we love ourselves, but most of all, to love God. Let us pray. Lord, we give thanks that you are not capricious. We are grateful that you are intentional. And we love the fact that you have chosen us, even though we sometimes have a hard time admitting it, recognizing it, realizing it. And so we ask, Lord, that you would open our hearts and minds to make the decisions that matter, today and every day, to choose others before we choose ourselves, to choose you before we choose anything, so that in all things, God, you might be honored, and that the kingdom represented by your Son might come to life, and that the world might be transformed. We pray that you will not let us leave it to chance. Call us clearly and loudly for the sake of the name of Jesus. Amen. Just in case you're thinking that this is the point at which, if God is calling you, It's going to come as a voice from the blue. I'm here to take that notion away from you. Just in case you're thinking that it's going to be some kind of miracle where a bush grows up out of the carpet here in front of the chancel rail, catches fire, and is not consumed, and a voice comes out of the bush and tells you what it is you're supposed to do with your Christian life, I'm here to take that notion away from you as well. I'm not going to say it can happen. I'm just here to say that it's probably not going to happen. Instead, I want you to listen to the sound of my voice, because I've been set apart and sent to give you this invitation. It is my privilege as well as my job. If you've never followed after Jesus Christ, if you've never sought to be a disciple, if you've never jockeyed for position between Matthias and Justice, but today you want to, then come forward and say so. Turn your life over to Jesus Christ and let that be your new beginning. If you've done it before, but you've been holding back, you've been throwing your money down the steps, or you've been flipping the coin, but it's got two heads instead of a heads and a tails, but you're ready to give all of that over to God, let today be the day you decide that. Let today be the day you decide that. If you're part of another congregation, but you are convinced that God wants you here, for whatever reason, whatever leading, whether it just makes more sense to you, or whether it's a call, a yearn deep within your heart, come forward and say so. Make that happen today. And finally, if you just need to come and pray at the chancel rail, I'm going to invite those who have something they want to say or a commitment that they need to make to meet me over here. Everybody else, just come to the chancel and pray as God leads you. And one last thing. If you don't feel comfortable coming here, meet me in the Sunday school room here in the back, where we'll do coffee with the pastor. There'll be two or three of us there to greet you. There'll be coffee. There will be donuts. That's pretty good incentive. But best of all, God will be with us as well. And if you want to make your commitments there in a private and more intimate space, then we understand. That's why we set it up this way. But don't just sit there. Don't wait for God to drag you out by the ear. God is waiting on you to make a commitment, no matter what that commitment looks like, whether you make it privately or in public. Hear the invitation and know that God is seeking you even now as we sing our song and go forth. as we give one another the benediction, remember to celebrate where you are able to. Celebrate the life of the mother who loved you. Celebrate the mothers among us. And go forth into this world to offer that same example to the people around us. Use these words as benediction for one another as we leave this place. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness and protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Amen.